Here are a couple of problems that came into my life recently. One situation had me trying to find an average yearly return on some investments, and another had me trying to find the average gas mileage we get as a family across our two main vehicles. I decided to give my university students similar problems just the other day. Each of the students had taken several math courses while at the university. But in spite of that, they had a hard time finding the correct answers. In fact, not one got the correct answer for the first problem I gave them. The issue wasn't a calculational issue. They did the calculations with a computer or calculator. The problem just asked for an average of a set of numbers. So how hard can that be? Well, before you go judging my students, I think most viewers would get the incorrect answers to these. So why are these average problems so hard? Well, it's because there are relatively few people that actually understand the fundamental idea of a mean, a generalized idea of an average. It seems many authors of textbooks and websites don't understand it either, so it's no wonder my students struggled so much. To better understand what's going on here, let's just try to solve these problems. Most of my students solved the interest rate problem by calculating the average in the way they learned in school. They took the sum of the values and divided by 3, since there are 3 numbers. I had them verify that the number they calculated was the actual average by calculating the value of my investments by the end of year 3 in 2 different ways, with the 3 different values and with their average value. Assuming simple interest in this problem, where the interest is applied at the end of the year, then we can calculate my total investment using this formula. So starting with $1,000, we get a total of about $1,218. Now we can do a similar calculation, but with the average rate we calculated. Instead of the 3 different returns, we calculate each year with the single average value, and we get something different, $1,355-ish. Well, this was a clue that the value we calculated couldn't actually be the average, because if we calculated the average correctly, we should have gotten the same outcome both ways. After all, the value I'm trying to find, the average value, is the single percentage I would get each year and still end up with the same total by the end of year 3. Let's try the other problem. My students were tempted to do the same strategy with this problem as with the last one. Add up the 2 values and divide by 2 to get a total of 25 miles per gallon. Well, like in the first problem, I had my students verify the average by calculating from scratch the average miles I would get per gallon if we drove each of our vehicles 6,000 miles. Knowing how many miles each car has driven, we need to find the number of gallons used to calculate the miles per gallon. Finding out how many gallons each car used when given miles per gallon and miles driven is as simple as following the units. We get miles per gallon times gallon equals miles, and we can use this equation to solve for gallons. Now we can calculate the number of gallons used by each vehicle, add them up, and divide by the total number of miles driven. That's 12,000. So we get a gas mileage of 21 miles per gallon. And that's not the same as 25, the value we got by adding up 15 and 35 and dividing by 2. The 21 miles per gallon value is the average that I'm after in this context, because if both vehicles got 21 miles per gallon, then I would use the same amount of gas as I'm using now. So what is going on? Why doesn't the natural and easy average calculation work for these problems? Well, let's think carefully about what a mean actually represents. The mean of a set of values applies to a situation where we have a set of values that we combine in some way to get a total. The mean of the set of values is the single value we could replace all of the other values with and still get the same total. But because there are different ways to create a total from a set of values, we could end up with different means, a different mean for each different way of creating the total. There are various reasons why we want to know a single value that gives us the same total, but usually it's to give us an idea of a typical value in the data set. Perhaps the simplest way of creating a total from a set of numbers is to sum them up. The sum of 1, 2, 3, and 5 is 11. What is the mean in this context? It is the single number I could replace 1, 2, 3, and 5 with and still get a sum of 11. What number is that? Well, we can set up a simple equation, x plus x plus x plus x equals 11, and solve. And we find that the mean is 11/4. When the total is the sum of the numbers, the mean is called the arithmetic mean. This is what most people think of when they think of average. Notice that the general concept of a mean gave us a way to calculate the mean for a specific total. We replaced each number by x, set the expression equal to the total, and solved. This will come in handy. Now that we have a better understanding of the idea of a mean in general, let's look back at our other problems. In the investment problem, notice we didn't sum the numbers to get our total. We did something different, which involved multiplication. Since we're doing a different operation to create our total, we wouldn't expect that the way to find our mean in this case would be the same as when the total was a simple sum. Let's take our expression to calculate our total earnings and replace our different percentage values with a single unknown value, and then solve for that unknown value. We find that the yearly growth rate that would earn us the same amount would be about 6.8%, so it makes sense to call that the mean in this context. If we calculate the total of a set of numbers as a product, then we would calculate our mean differently. This mean is called the geometric mean, which relates to the idea of geometric growth in mathematics. We could find our average interest rate by calculating the geometric mean of 1 plus our percentages, since those are the numbers we multiplied to get our total. What about our gas mileage problem? We didn't just add or multiply for that problem. If we take the work we did and simplify it, we see that the 6,000 miles for each vehicle cancels out. That means we could get the same mileage if we found the amount of gas used just driving 1 mile each per vehicle. Then the gas used is the reciprocal of our gas mileage. The total gas is the sum of those reciprocals, but that is the gas for 2 miles. So dividing by 2 gets us the amount of gas to drive 1 mile on average. But this is gallons per mile. It's no longer miles per gallon. So we need to take the reciprocal of that value to get miles per gallon. Wow, what in the world is that operation? There is an arithmetic mean in here, but it isn't the arithmetic mean of the mileages. It's the arithmetic mean of the reciprocal of the mileages. But then we take the reciprocal of that arithmetic mean. So we could call this operation the reciprocal of the arithmetic mean of the reciprocals. But this operation comes up enough that mathematicians give it another name, the harmonic mean. It is called the harmonic mean because of the connection to the harmonic series in mathematics, which deals with the reciprocal of the counting numbers. The harmonic mean comes up when finding averages of some rates, but not all rates. It depends on how the rate's given. For example, in many countries around the world, mileage is given as liters per 100 kilometers. To find the average gas mileage given in liters per 100 kilometers, we can just use the arithmetic mean. Why don't we need to use the harmonic mean? Because to calculate the total gas used when given in miles per gallon, we need to use the reciprocal of the mileage. But the total gas used when represented by liters per 100 kilometers doesn't require a reciprocal. If you drive each car 100 kilometers, then you just add the mileages together to get the total gas used. So the rule of thumb is that if you need to reciprocate to find the total, then you probably need the harmonic mean. So we've seen 3 different ways to calculate totals, and each one requires a different method for finding the mean in that context. We could just make up some method to calculate a new total from a set of values, and there would probably be a different mean involved. For example, we could square all the numbers before adding them up. We can set up an expression to find the mean in this situation, replacing each value with x and then solving. So with our initial values of 1, 2, 3, and 5, we get a mean of 3.12. We could derive a formula for this mean, and we could give the mean a name. Well, actually, it already has a name. It's called the root mean square, or often the root mean square error, because it's applied to errors in statistical models a lot. Most viewers have bumped into this in a stats class when calculating the standard deviation of a data set, because the differences from the mean are squared, then summed. So the standard deviation is a mean, just a mean for a different method of calculating the total. So why are there so many different means in math and statistics? Because there are a lot of different and useful ways to calculate totals from a set of values. And how do you know which mean to use in a particular situation? It all comes down to the operation that was used to get the total used in the given context. With the way we've made sense of a mean, or different kinds of means, we can now see why most instructional resources are so poor. Take this website, for example. It starts off by defining the mean as the algorithm for calculating the arithmetic mean. That isn't very helpful for understanding what the mean is, though. What a mean is, or what it's supposed to represent, is different than how to calculate it. This website does define the mean later as the average, which still isn't very helpful if you're just learning the idea, since if students don't know one of these, they probably don't know the other. Even Wikipedia defines the arithmetic mean by the calculation method, and not by the meaning of the value calculated by that method. Luckily, the Wikipedia page for mean emphasizes the idea of a central or typical value of a dataset, but it doesn't go far enough to help readers understand the connection between the calculation of a total amount and the specific value of a mean. Now when someone asks you for an average, you can ask which one they mean. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.